Come on, boy. You know, I had the pleasure of going on a tour with this gentleman and hearing his dynamic poetry. And at one time, we were like the kings of poetry, traveling around, doing our thing, rapid-fire poetry. We was lighting them up in South Carolina, you know? So it's my pleasure, my honor, to introduce my man, the one wise African, Mr. Joe Briggs.
I got into the habit of not using a microphone. Because I don't want you to think that this is coming from one of these fancy machines. I want you to know this is coming from a human being.
All right.
56 years old, I feel in good company. December 8th, 1955, that's when I was born. I grew up 6 blocks from here, around the corner from the Coco Club, the mile-long sandwich shop, right there on the corner of 8th and H. When I was growing up, you could get anywhere in D.C. from that corner. Anywhere. You could get on the Lafayette Square bus and go ride right down to the White House. Smoke a joint on the way. You could get the H2 and go Staten Road. Over to Attica. You could go anywhere in D.C. from that corner. And anybody in D.C. could get to that corner from wherever they were. So I got a chance to meet a whole lot of different people coming from different places, going to different spaces with a whole lot of different ideas. And some of them stuck. So I appreciate your cooperation, I really do. But I don't need your permission. This spoken word thing with me, this ain't no hobby, this ain't no pastime. I am on a mission. I'm coming to you from a space where nobody care what you think. Give a damn how you feel. A space where your love life will be reduced to fantasy. But the pain, the frustration, the violence, oh, that's all very real. I am coming to you from the headlines, from the front lines, from a struggle I hope you'll never have to fight. These are the most salient reasons why I gotta write. I have to write. These lines are my life, and the things I write and perform are not the culmination of my vivid imagination. I put my life on these lines, arranged in rhymes, hoping that they might stay on your mind. I'm praying that your lives will be so much better than mine. In prison cells, I've spent way too much time. So I gotta write. I have to write. These lines are my life. 8 years into a 19-year prison bid, I got on my knees, folded my hands like I used to when I was a kid, and I prayed, dear God, help me through this. And what do you know? He did. But that's not all I had to say as I knelt on that cold concrete floor to pray. I promised the Most High that if I should survive, if I should make it out of this hellhole alive, that I would use this gift that he has so abundantly blessed me with. Gather up all the pain, frustration, and rage, commit them all to a page. Put them together, put them to good use. Stand on street corners or well-lit stages and spit nothing but the truth. Oh, I gotta write. I have to write. These lines are my life. That's why I'm wide awake, 3 in the morning, scribbling down another encouraging word or yet another warning, because some kind of way I'm gonna communicate to you that with hard work and determination, all your dreams can come true. But if you're lazy and impatient, all your nightmares will too. Oh, I gotta write. I have to write. These lines are my life. And I know that there are those that think they know me that's going to find this a little odd. But for real, when I'm doing what I do, I'm just keeping a promise I made. God, I got to write. I have to write. These lines are my life.
Yes.
I'm serious, sister, you look like a teenager. I was making sure that there were no children in the room before I do this next piece, because this ain't for kids. A lot of my life has been wonderful and beautiful and heartwarming. And some of my life has been ugly and trying. Yeah. Don't I look civilized? Well, when I was a child, you know, 4 or 5, I thought in dark closets or under my bed was where evil monsters would hide. Yet later in life, once when enraged and twice when utterly terrified, I met a seething, breathing, bloodthirsty beast that lives inside. See, a lot of y'all ain't never met this beast, don't know the monster I'm speaking of, but just wait till your very life hangs in the balance, or worse yet, the life of someone you really love. You may one day see someone you know to be polite and pleasant, personality neat and mild, turn into a screaming savage when something or someone is hurting their child. Oh, this beast is usually asleep, you know, just chilling in its cage. But it does have certain wake-up calls, the most common, fear and rage. Now, rage flares up, burns hot, but usually burns out kind of fast. And rage, one might punch you in your mouth or straight kick that ass. Yeah, rage is strong and volatile, yet fear is stronger still. See, in rage, one might scream and punch and such, but a frightened man will kill. Oh, I've seen a young man beaten to death with a Weber grill lid. And the guy that administered the beating went into a kind of a trance. It was later the neighbors had to tell him what he did. I've read an account of a small Asian lady that accomplished an incredible feat. Alone, she lifted the front end of a Buick because her child was trapped underneath. Yeah, I've seen and heard and read all kinds of accounts about how adrenaline affects the muscle mass's effectiveness and a whole slew of other rationalizing mess. But I know there's a monster that lives in us all. And certain triggers set it free. I say I know because 3 times so far I've met that beast in me. Now this is a long way from shame, but it don't quite approach pride. That second time I met this beast inside, I was in prison, locked up in a steel and concrete cage. But now, this is an example of how that beast can be released by both fear and rage. I had just been transferred to a new joint. Later on that same night, I felt a strong forearm around my throat, hot breath in my ear. What's it gonna be, nigga? Shit on my dick or blood on this knife? Big cat, I mean, had to be 6'6" or more. He had me by the throat, I'm 6'3". And my feet weren't touching the floor. And I said, stop that! You choking me! Wait! Man, don't do nothing on them filthy shit. You ain't even really hard yet, brother, baby. Wait. I'll put some clean sheets on that bed. But I'm gonna get you real hard by giving you some of this super hair that we don't need no more than roughed up, bro. And would you believe this idiot? Let me go. Oh, it was on. First strike, stiff finger, straight to his eyes, and the beast was released by that look on his face. The pain and surprise. And see, yeah, see, some of y'all know how this close-in fighting goes. It's all about shoulders, knees, elbows. I clamped down on the arm of the hand that held the knife, and I knew right then I was in a fight for my life. And this wasn't something that was planned out. This was instinct. This was reflex. Headbutted this big ass, and with these teeth, clamped into his neck. Ladies and gentlemen, blood from the jugular vein does not leak out. It spurts. And the monster in me was dancing a jig. Oh, goddamn, I know that hurts. And that foul-tasting liquid quickly filled my mouth, and I had to open up and spit that shit out. And I spit it out on him. But this brain-dead individual let me get hold of his neck with these teeth again. But this time, had a better grip. Wasn't no way I was about to slip. I don't care how he punched, kneed, elbowed, pulled. I hung on. Heard myself growling, shaking my head like a goddamn pit bull. I don't know whether it was shock, loss of blood, I guess. But eventually he slid down that wall into unconsciousness. And I used these hands and feet and knees and turned his face into a bloody mess. Drug his big ass over to the bars, stripped off the sheets and started to tie him up. I thought he was gonna come to before he was through, but I kept slipping in the blood. Oh yeah, head wounds bleed a lot. And the monster in me just sort of chuckles and come to. Oh no, he will not! Count time! The guard doing count coming near. She got to our cell and said, count, oh my God! And went running back down the tier. In the next 15 seconds, I don't think I have ever felt so utterly alone. as if the beast in me just split, said, I did my part, not you on your own. 4 months I spent in the hole behind this incident. And when I finally did get to the big yard, a young man I'd never seen before was elbowing his partner, pointing, no, not at all, and in the glass, oh, dude, his heart ran up to me screaming, oh, gee, man, that shit you did to Bo was motherfucking spectacular. You know what? We gonna start calling you Kelp. Oh, my God, Dracula. I started getting the what's up nod from some of the older men. One of them told me straight up, I knew somebody was gonna kick that bull's ass. Just didn't know when. Then came the ultimate gesture of respect and trust. Jay Busy, a baller out of East Palo Alto, said, yo, yo, dude, yo, yeah, man, I don't give a fuck where you from. You can sit over here with us. So like I say, this is a long way from shame, but it don't quite approach pride. That second time I met this beast and see, side, and see, some of y'all done met your beast, and you know that I ain't lying. Right in here breathes a creature more cunning than any fox, more vicious than any lion. And those of you that haven't yet, or when you do, don't you dare stand around in the bloody aftermath looking all shocked and surprised. Don't act like you don't know, because I just told you so. Dark closets and under beds, that ain't where monsters hide. The most vicious beast you'll ever meet is alive and well, and living inside. I have a CD. I've gotten so used to not doing this in D.C. Tobar, we tour the South. Oh, we get paid. Where we go, come back to D.C., can't make it down. Anyway, I've got 3 CDs. One with no profanity on it. One that's in the middle, and the other one. Yeah, the other one starts off with the one I just did. So, you know, if you want to take a little slice of me home with you, just let me know. The other thing he was talking about, a host. That sort of gurgled up. I didn't mean to say that when you said think. Here's a clue. If you think you can, you can't. If you know you can, you can. When you're going to do something, you don't tell people, oh, I'm going to try to make it. That's a setup for an excuse not to show up. Because when you tell somebody, I'll be there. Enough said, I'll be there. Not I'm going to try to make it. Because when you say you're going to try to make it, that means you're not coming. Right? When you say, I can do that, I can watch your grandson for you, I can't, you know. So from tonight on, I'd like you to be more conscious of what you say out your mouth. Because how you feel is how you think. And how you think is how you act. So if you have no confidence, get some. Really. It's important that you know who you are, what you're capable of doing, and be brave enough to tell the truth to the people that ask you for whatever. If you can't do it, say it. You know. And if you can do it, do it. Love y'all.
Love that. Right. My man, Joe Briggs.